Allahu Akbar.
Without further ado, I would like to call up the esteemed Jeremy McLellan. Let's get a round of applause. Let's go!
Assalamu alaikum, everybody. Thank you so much. It's good to be here. My name is Jeremy McLellan. I'm a stand-up comedian. It's awesome to be here. I have really, really enjoyed ICNA so far. I was also asked to perform at ISNA, but I already have a wife, so I don't need to do that, so it's fine. They told me we were running a little bit late today, and I said, I know, I often perform at Muslim events. I totally understand. Matter of fact, that's my theory for why Trump won, is just all the Muslims in America are just now showing up to vote. They're like, wait a minute, I don't... That's taken a while to getting used to, because like I'm white, and like white people are on time for everything except civil rights, right? And then it's like, then we're like 50 years behind, so. Comedians don't often perform for audiences like this, and by that I mean people who are sober. It's very interesting, it's very cool. I love performing for sober crowds. It's great. I'm glad y'all are sober. I read a statistic online that 1 in 3 traffic fatalities involve drunk driving. Yeah. Which means that 2/3 involve sober driving. Which means that sober driving is twice as dangerous as drunk driving. So please, if any of you get to the end of the night and you realize you're too sober to drive home, please call a designated drunk driver to come pick you up. All right. We call those Uber. Uber. I love Uber. I love Uber because like Uber is not just a corporation. Uber is a sign of peace. It's a sign of religious coexistence because Uber is an app that was invented by a Jew so that when Christians get too drunk, we can call a Muslim to come pick us up and take us home. It's just this beautiful, beautiful connection of wonderful, wonderful things. One of the first shows I ever did as a stand-up comedian was for a Muslim charity. And I remember I was pretty nervous. I didn't know what to expect, didn't know what the rules were, right? Thankfully, they sent me a contract in the mail. I opened it up, and it had 2 rules in it. Rule number 1, it said all your material has to be family-friendly. I was like, you know what? No problem. I can do family-friendly. They were like, rule number 2, you can't do any jokes about the difference between Sunni and Shia. I was like, again, that is not going to be a problem because I don't know the difference between Sunni and Shia. I mean, I know the difference now. I know the difference now, but like even now I have no idea what they were worried about, right? Like what happened the previous year at that event where they had to put that in the contract? Like someone showed up at the event and just got on stage and did a solid hour of Sunni versus Shia jokes. They got on stage, they were just like, so I got stuck behind this guy in traffic today. Obviously a Sunni. You guys know what I'm talking about. You guys know what I'm talking about. You know Shia don't tip, right? No, I don't know the stereotypes, right? I don't know enough about that to make those kind of jokes, right? And like, I want my comedy to come from a place of knowledge rather than a place of ignorance, you know? That's me. I want my comedy to come from a place of knowledge rather than a place of ignorance. Yeah, you can clap, that's fine, yeah. And the reason why I do that is not because I'm trying not to be offensive. I don't really care about that. What I do care about is being funny, and I think those are the jokes that are best, right? The ones that are actually based in knowledge. I'll give you an example. I was in Houston doing a show, and right after the show, this Pakistani guy came up to me, and he was like, why don't you do any Hindu jokes? He was like really upset. He was like, why don't you do any Hindu jokes? I was like, again, because I don't know enough about Hinduism to tell like a really good joke about it, right? Like if I tried to tell a joke about Hinduism, it probably wouldn't be very good. It wouldn't be very funny. No one would laugh. The joke itself would die on stage, right? But like knowing me, I wouldn't give up on that joke. The next night I would try to tell it again, try to bring it back to life. Again, no one would laugh. It would die on stage. Next night I would keep bringing it back to life. It would keep dying, keep bringing it back to life, 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 keep dying. Until one day it would achieve perfect comedy. And that's my Hindu joke. I don't know if you... Got that. I had to put that joke in there because for the past week, I have been battling Hindu extremists on my Facebook page. You guys see this? Do you guys see this? I posted something bad about these cow vigilantes they have in India, and I was just inundated. I had this huge, huge influx of what are known as Modi bots, right? Am I pronouncing that correctly? People who support Prime Minister Modi of India, and just tons of them, hundreds of them, were like on my page trolling me for like an entire week. It was very overwhelming, sending me death threats, sending me a lot of hate messages. And what would I do? I would ban them, right? I would ban them from my page. They would create new profiles and then send me more death threats, more hate messages, trolling, right? So I would ban them again, and they would keep creating new profiles. And like, I have nothing against Hindus, right? I have nothing against Hindus. But I think if you are a Hindu and you don't want me making fun of you, you shouldn't keep reincarnating yourself on Facebook with new profiles to attack me. I have nothing against Hindus. I'm just saying you're asking for it, right? You're asking for it. I've been doing these kind of shows for several years now. I love them so much. I love doing shows for Muslims. And one thing I had to learn was the correct pronunciation of the word Muslim, right? Because most Americans don't say it right. Most Americans pronounce it Muslim with a Z, or Moslem, or Muslim. It's a very popular one, right? And if you say it wrong, a lot of Muslims will correct you, unless you're Bernie Sanders. Then you can say it however you want. Like, y'all just let Bernie say whatever he wants, and that's totally fine, right? But like, in our defense, Muslims mispronounce the names of other religions all the time, right? Like, sometimes instead of saying Christian, I'll hear you mispronounce it and say Christian. I'm like, that's not how you say it, right? It's not how you say it. Or like, sometimes instead of saying the word Jewish, I'll hear you mispronounce it and say Zionist. It's just a very common sort of mispronunciation. Let me take a drink of water with that one. No, one of the very first shows I ever did for a Muslim group was at the Sacramento Muslim Student Association, the MSA. And I remember I was pretty nervous. I didn't know what to expect. So I was supposed to meet the organizer beforehand. Her name is Aya. She's great. She's an awesome, awesome woman. But the only thing I knew about her was that she was a Muslim woman, and her profile picture was a Palestinian flag. That's all I knew about her. But I was supposed to meet her at a coffee shop about 2 hours beforehand. So I'm sitting there, just like a dumb white Christian guy, just sitting in the coffee shop, waiting for her to get there. And then in walks in a woman wearing hijab, and I jump up, and I'm like, Aya, what's up? It's Jeremy. And she was like, I don't know what you're talking about. And I'm like, okay, I'm sorry. Sorry. Just starting the day off with a little racial profiling. I'm sorry. Just sit back down. 15 minutes later, Aya walks in. She's like, are you Jeremy? I'm like, yeah. She's like, thank goodness, because I just said hi to a white guy outside. I was like, all right, we're even. I do have some awkward moments doing these kind of shows. I was at a show in Louisiana, I believe it was. And after the show, this woman came up to me. She was a Pakistani auntie, and I love them. I love Pakistani aunties. They always come up to me after shows with like trays of biryani, right? I love biryani. They like give it to me. It's like an 8x12 of biryani. And I'm like about to get on a flight. And I'm like, yeah, I'll take it through security. I'll do that. And then I'll just be on the flight like with a tray of biryani, just offering it to people like behind the flight attendants. Like, would you like some biryani? Yeah, you would, okay. You like biryani? Great, terrific. That's how I spread joy, you know, on those United flights that are so upsetting. They needed biryani, I'm sorry. They needed it. If they had biryani at all, it would have been fine, right? But I was in Louisiana, I was doing a show, and this auntie came out to me afterwards, and she didn't have food, she had some calligraphy. She had a piece of wood that had Arabic writing on it, okay? And she gave it to me, and she was like, I really want you to have this, because I do calligraphy, and it would really mean a lot to me if you would take this. And I was like, yeah, thank you, okay, that's a very nice thing to give to me. I really appreciate it. And she was like, and it would really mean a lot to me if you would take a selfie with it and then post it on your Facebook page. And I was like, you know what? That does sound nice. I'm gonna do that. That is so nice. I'm gonna be nice to this woman. I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna pitch her her company or whatever. And so I take a selfie with it. I'm about to post it. And I'm like, I need to find out what this says, right? I don't speak Arabic. I have no idea what this says. So I text it to an Arab friend of mine, and he texted back. He was like, yeah, don't post that. I was like, why not? He was like, that's the Shahada. I was like, what is that? He's like, that's the thing you say to become or announce to the entire world that you have become a Muslim. And I was like, she was trying to trick me. Like, I even asked her, I was like, what does it say? She's like, it's just Arabic. I wouldn't really worry about it. Don't worry about that. Right? But I had so many thoughts from this. I had so many thoughts. The first thought I had was like, obviously that is disrespectful. It's not okay to try to trick someone into converting, right? Don't do that, right? But number two, you know, as forced conversions go, pretty mild, right? Like, if we could just get the entire world to move towards pranks, the world would be a much better place where you just be like, here, hold this wooden tea. You're a Christian now, okay, right? That would be great. But number three, and this is the most important thing that I could not understand, was that she thought it would work, right? She thought it would take, right? So, like, I'd post it on my Facebook page, and then it would, like, get a bunch of likes, and then all the congratulations would start flowing in, and I'd be like, oh, no. Well, I mean, I already posted it, so there's a lot of likes. Stephanie, that's my wife. Stephanie, yeah, we're Muslim now. I don't know what. No, I can't delete it. It got 1.6 billion likes. I can't delete that, right? Totally understandable. Totally understandable. I'm from South Carolina. Anyone here from South Carolina? Anyone here ever been to South Carolina by accident? Maybe you got lost and you ended up in South Carolina. I love it. I love South Carolina, but like whenever I travel, people always assume that just because I'm from South Carolina, I must be racist, right? Or I must be like really, really conservative. But South Carolina actually has a very rich progressive history. I don't know if you guys know this, but South Carolina actually started the war that ended slavery. So you're welcome, everyone. We're welcome. We did it. We did it. Oh, man. I have to tell you guys this story. It's such a good story. It's a story of the best joke I ever heard. Best joke I ever heard, I heard when I was 15 years old, and I have never been able to top it. So when I was 15, and for most of my life, I worked with people with intellectual disabilities. That's what I've done for most of my life since I was 15, right up until last year. That's what I did with most of my life, working with people with intellectual disabilities, making sure they weren't being abused or neglected or financially exploited. That's what I did. However, one thing you may not know is that Jeremy McLellan with two C's, this is true, went to prison for financially exploiting people with intellectual disabilities. So, found that out during a background check. My last name is spelled with one C, his is spelled with two. Please spell it correctly whenever you go, because the other guy is in a jail in St. Louis. So, but going back to my story, when I was 15, I heard the best joke I've ever heard. So, I was working at a camp for people with disabilities in rural South Carolina, working there with my brother. Also working there was a guy who was kind of a jerk. Not a very nice guy, very impatient with the clients. He wasn't abusive or neglectful, like he wasn't Jeremy McLellan with two C's, right? He was just not a very nice person. And so one day, my brother and I decided to have a little fun with him because one day, this guy who was a real jerk, he got bitten on his arm by a guy with Down syndrome. And my brother and I decided to have a little fun. And we told him everything was going to be okay because, after all, he had had his Down syndrome shot. He was like, I haven't had my Down syndrome shot. I'm like, you haven't had your Down syndrome shots? Like, dude, it's on the list of inoculations you have to get in order to work at the camp. There's the Down syndrome shot. There's the autism vaccine, which causes polio, by the way, I hear. And there's no cure for Down syndrome. And so you're in a really tough spot. Dude starts freaking out, right? He gets scared, he's sweating, he's fidgeting, he is really, really scared. And so we decide just to prolong his agony, right? Just to prolong his agony, we walk him down a quarter of a mile to the nurse's station. walk him down there. We explain to the nurse what's going on. And the nurse turns around and says, son, these boys are lying to you. And we were like, no. And she was like, there is a cure. And we're like, yes. Nurse, what's up? This is the best. She's like, there is a cure, but we're all the way out in rural South Carolina. It's going to take a while for poison control to get here with the antidotes. And we're like, yes. Nurse, this is the best day of my life. Now, this is when the story goes from good to great. Because in the nurse's station, sitting down, was a second guy with Down syndrome. And he saw what was going on. He assessed the situation, and he chimed in with, hey, man, it's going to be okay. I used to be staff. We were like, what is happening? He's like, I used to be staff, then I got bitten, and it's really, we're like, what is going on? He's like fake consoling the guy, like, you get used to it. It's not a bad life. You get to go to camps. It's amazing, right? And we couldn't take it anymore. We burst out laughing, and that was it. But that is still the best joke that I've ever heard in my entire life. So good. So good. Told by a guy with Down syndrome when I was 15. I love him. So I worked with that population for about 15 years, and during that time, my favorite client that I ever worked with was a guy named Saeed, okay? And Saeed and his family were Pakistani Muslims. Any Pakistani Muslims here? Yeah, give it up, give it up. Yeah. And this was in a period in my life when I was pretty depressed. I didn't have a lot going in my life. I hadn't started doing comedy yet. I hadn't met the right person, you know. Didn't have a lot going on in my life. But I worked with Saeed, and he and his family were Pakistani Muslims, and they invited me into their homes. They showed me love. They showed me care and hospitality. They made me feel welcome. And most importantly, every 2 weeks, they had me over to eat biryani. And that is when I fell in love with biryani. And I remember the first time I ever had biryani. I went over to their house. I was nervous, didn't know what to expect. So I was over there, and I sat down. They gave me a big plate of biryani, and I did what any good Southern boy would do, right? I cleaned my plate, I ate all the biryani, including all the cardamom, and I was just tears were just streaming down my face. I was like, this is really good. No, this is delicious. Yeah, no, I am so white right now. I don't know, can I get some yogurt and just drink it? No, it was terrifying. His dad walks over, his dad's like, did you eat all the... You didn't take anything? I was like, no, I know now. I'm sorry. Just tears just streaming down my face. Somehow, that did not scar me for life. I have no idea how. But one day, it's my favorite story of Saeed, of me and the time that I spent with him. But one day, Saeed's dad called me up, and he asked me to accompany him on a trip to California to see his grandparents. And Saeed's dad was a little nervous about Saeed getting through airport security. For a few reasons. Number one and two, he was Pakistani and Muslim, right? So strike one and two, we understand, right? But number three, Saeed was autistic, which meant that going through airport security, he would be sweating, fidgeting, pacing, not making eye contact, and asking lots of questions about how planes work. And this is 2010, his favorite movie at the time was My Name is Khan. So not the best movie you want to be reciting at airports. And he had the whole thing memorized. So it fell to me to kind of explain to him and to coach him through this, right? I spent about a month working with him, getting him ready for this trip, right? And I didn't really know how to explain it, so I sat him down, and I was like, Saeed, he was a smart guy, but I sat him down, and I was like, Saeed, because of what bin Laden did on 9/11, right? Supposedly, we know. I'm just kidding. Right, I'm just kidding. Because of that, the government is suspicious of people who look like you, right? And because you're autistic, maybe you'll seem extra suspicious, like you're going to do something wrong. None of that is your fault. None of that is your fault. It's just the sad world we live in today. But we need to practice, right? We need to prepare. So I pretend to be the TSA agent, right? I asked him, where's your boarding pass? Have you ever been to a foreign country? Where are your parents from? Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And we practiced for weeks. And then the big day came. And we go to the airport, and we're in the line, and he walks up to the TSA agents and says, hi, I'm Saeed, and I'm not a terrorist. I may seem like a terrorist, this is all true. I may seem like a terrorist because I'm Pakistani and autistic. However, I'm not. And he really added this. He was like, and I will have you know, I strongly disagree with what bin Laden did. Now look, in Saeed's defense and his defense, the phrase strongly disagree is the strongest option on many forms and surveys and questionnaires. But I feel like when you're talking about 9/11, you want to use a little stronger language, right? Like, it's a little bit like saying, I believe slavery was rude. You're like, well, it was rude. Gonna need to use a little stronger language. And at this point, I'm getting scared because I have no idea what he's gonna say about me, right? Like, this is the guy who trained me. Yeah, taught me everything I need to know about terrorism. And he coached me on how to get through security without raising any red flags. And he packed my bags this morning. I was like, okay. I did pack his bags. Thankfully, they took it all in stride and let us through without any other issues. So it all worked out very well. And so that's my Saeed story. But people have trouble at the airports. I don't normally have trouble at airports because I'm white, and that's fine. People say that the TSA is Islamophobic, right? People say that. But like to me, like, is there anything more Muslim than getting millions of Americans to take their shoes off? Like, it's just perfect, right? It's like, it makes perfect sense. I don't have a lot of problems at the airport. I did have one problem. About 9 months ago, I was going through the airport, and I got pulled out of line, right? And questioned and frisked and really, really grilled because my business cards, this is still true, my business cards have a picture of a grenade on them. And they pulled me out of line, they questioned me a lot, right? Which I think makes perfect sense, because, like, you know how terrorists usually carry business cards, you know, like to hand out at all their, like, terrorism conferences? And they always make sure to put a picture of a grenade on there, like, just so there's no confusion. Just so there's no confusion. Makes perfect sense. My favorite story that happened about a year ago was there was a man, he was an economist, and he was on a flight, and he was doing math on a napkin. Who heard this story? Yep, a few of you. He was doing math on a napkin on his way to an economics conference. And the woman next to him, who I found out later, was from Charleston, South Carolina. I was like, no, right? She saw him doing math on the napkin. She saw that he was Italian, which I guess is close enough, I don't know, and reported him to the flight attendant for being a terrorist, right? Yeah, for doing math on a napkin. And the plane did not take off. They, like, stopped. They, like, did not take off for hours while they questioned the guy. And to me, when this happened, there were all these jokes my Muslim friends were making about, like, you know, how, like, oh, you know, well, you know, Muslims invented algebra, right? Maybe that's what tipped her off. Or, like, the X. Maybe that was, like, Malcolm X, you know? But for me, my favorite part of this story is that she thought that he was a terrorist, but not a very prepared terrorist. She thought he had to do just some, like, last minute calculations where he's just like, think, why do you always wait until the last second? You always procrastinate. Okay, what's that formula? Can I borrow a pen? Yeah, okay, thank you so much. I'm gonna borrow a pen. Okay, now think back to middle school. What was that? Okay. X equals negative B plus or minus the square root of B squared minus 4AC all over 2. You got it. Very, very strange. Very strange. I don't like flying. I like driving. It's my favorite thing to do. I love driving. My favorite thing to do when I drive is I have a GPS, and I turn it up really, really, really loud, and then I put it in my trunk. And then I just pretend I kidnapped somebody helpful. Like, in 100 feet, take a left. Thank you so much. I will take a left. That is so very nice. I really appreciate that. It's great. It's great. How has the last year been for y'all? Yeah? Okay, some okay. Who died last year? Muhammad Ali? Sting? No, Sting didn't die. Prince? Right? Prince died. Harambe? That's the most important one. Harambe died. Carrie Fisher? Right? Democracy? Did you guys hear that? Democracy died in the past year. Did you guys hear that? The Republic? America passed away. The Constitution is on life support. I don't know if you guys heard that. It's very scary. Lots of really scary things. I try to keep some hope, though, with the whole political system. I try to keep hope, you know, because, like, I don't know, this whole past year has just reminded me of what my mom always told me growing up, right? She always told me a few things. She always said, Jeremy, whenever God closes a door, sometimes he just keeps closing doors, and it's just door after door after door, and you're like, we could use a window. Right about now, please. We could really use a window. A lot of people are really scared right now. A lot of people are saying that Donald Trump might be the next Hitler. Have you guys heard this? You guys have heard that? Yeah, a lot of people are saying that Donald Trump might be the next Hitler. And by people, I mean his supporters. They're like, oh my goodness. I think this guy might be the next Hitler. I'm so excited. I feel like he could be the next Hitler. I'm so thrilled. Like, oh my goodness. I'm so thrilled. No, just to be clear, I do not think that supporting Donald Trump makes you racist, okay? I do not think that. I think it's a lot more likely that you were already racist, and that's why you support Donald Trump. It's an issue of causation rather than anything else. I think I'd rather have a king than a president, you know? We might get one. I'd rather have a king than a president, because think about it. If you get a bad king, it doesn't say anything bad about you as a people, you know? You're just like, oh, well, we got a bad king. That doesn't say anything bad about us, right? Makes total sense. But having a bad president, that's like, that says something really bad about you as a people, right? It says something about you, right? Like, having a king is like having an arranged marriage, you know? Whether you like the person or not, it doesn't say anything bad about you, right? But like, having a bad president, that's like meeting your wife on eHarmony. Because like all the technology, all the algorithms in the world are telling you that like this is your soulmate, right? And you show up for the first date and it's Donald Trump. And you're like, I think I have a bad soul. I think I have a bad soul. That's what I learned from this. But his supporters do scare me a lot more than he does, I think. I don't know if you guys agree with that, but his supporters do scare me, like, a lot more than he does. I remember I was in Indiana. I was driving through, and I stopped, and I visited some Muslim friends of mine. And they were telling me this really scary story. They told me that about a few months ago, on a Sunday, there were a bunch of, like, Christian Trump supporters who put on pig masks and got AR-15s and protested outside of their mosque for hours and hours and hours. And when they told me this, I was really offended. Like, I was really upset for them, right? For them, for their community, scared they were going to face, you know, violence. But I was also offended as a Christian, right? Because as Christians, as supposedly followers of Jesus, we are not supposed to work on Sunday. You can look it up. That's a sin, right? That's my new rule for Christians. It's like, if you have time to do that on a Sunday, you can keep Chick-fil-A open. That's my rule. That's my rule, right? I told that joke in rural South Carolina, and this guy came up to me afterwards, and he was like, you know it's different, though. I was like, what? He's like, you know those are two different things. I was like, how? He's like, you know those are different because the people who were protesting, they weren't getting paid. I was like, oh, well, then it's totally fine, right? Like, as long as all your Islamophobia is, like, pro bono, then it's totally okay. Like, as long as all your hate crimes are, like, on the house, it's just like, bro, me to you. Me to you. Just want you to know that. Just want you to know that. I don't know. I was in Houston doing a show there. And yeah, anybody from Houston? A few people. Yeah, a few people. Cool. So I went there, and there was a white supremacist protest at the Islamic Dawah Center there, right, in Houston. And I was just visiting, but I had a friend who's Muslim call me up, and he was like, we really want you to come to the Islamic Dawah Center and listen, and we have a microphone for you and a speaker, and we just want to see you roast them for, like, a few hours. And I was like, I'm on board. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. And so I went there. And it was a white supremacist rally. Well, it didn't say white supremacist rally. It had a giant banner that said White Lives Matter. And I was like, thank you so much. Thank you so much. Because, like, sometimes, like, you don't know if your life matters. And then you see that and you're like, you know what? It does. My life matters. White people's lives matter. You don't hear it often enough. I just, you know, it's just so, so, so great, right? But second thing is that the name of the group, the name of the group was Stop the Islamization of Texas. That was the name of the group, right, that did the whole protest. And two thoughts on that. Number one, if y'all are thinking of trying to Islamicize a state, I wouldn't start with Texas, right? Pick like Delaware or Connecticut. They'll just let you do it. It'll take 2 weeks. It's totally fine. But number two, to me, Islamicize sounds like a drink order at a halal restaurant. Like, I'd like a chai, please, and yes, I would like that Islamicized. Thank you so much. Just really Islamicized it. I want, like, the biggest cup of chai you have. I thought that would be great. But I get a lot of hate online. It happens a lot, especially whenever I announce I'm doing a show like this. I get a lot of hate online. I get a lot of horrible messages. One common message I get from people who hate Muslims, they message me, and they say, Jeremy, don't do it. You can't trust Muslims. And I'm like, why? And they're like, because they're allowed to lie about whether they're Muslim. And I'm like, are you Muslim? And they're like, no. I'm like, how do I know? And that's where the conversation usually ends. I love doing that. It's my favorite thing in the world. It's so fun. Especially over the past week, I've been getting a lot of death threats online. It's something that you have that happens online. Some of them are specific, and those you can report to the FBI. Some of them say, like, I'm going to kill you tomorrow. And you're like, all right, well, good luck, but I can pass it on to the FBI. Others you can't report because they're too vague. They're like, I hope you die one day. And I'm like, yeah, me too, right? Like, I hope I don't live forever. Like, I want to die. I want to have a good death, right? Right? Totally makes sense. I don't want to be cursed with immortality, right? But, like, my big fear isn't dying. My big fear is dying for something stupid. That's my big fear. Like I want to die either of old age or I want to be assassinated. Those are the two ways I want to die. That's how I want to die. Either old age or I want to get assassinated. Or, preferably, I would love to get assassinated right before I die of old age. So, like, I'm in the hospital bed, like, dying, and then the assassin walks in. I'm like, where have you been? He's like, I know I'm late. And I'm like, all right, let's do this, right? That would be great. That's what I would like. But instead, I'm always, like, almost dying for stupid, stupid reasons. About a year ago, I went hiking in the woods, and I got bitten by a tick. This is true. Gotten bitten by a tick on my knee, and I contracted Rocky Mountain spotted fever and almost died. That's a true story. It's a true story. I was very, very scared. It was very terrifying. I was in the hospital, and I asked all my friends to come and, you know, make fun of me because they're all comedians, right? And they all came to my hospital bed and listened to me and, visited me. And I asked them to please keep me in their prayers. And they all said they would, except for one. He was like, well, I'm going to keep you in my thoughts. I was like, it didn't bother me that he was an atheist. I just felt like that was a weird time to pick a fight, you know? Like, hey, man, hope you don't die, but just in case you do, just wanted you to know heaven's not real. Yeah. Get well soon. Your religion's stupid, right? And look, like, my religion might be stupid. Like, prayer may not work. I think it does, but maybe it doesn't, right? But I think if prayer doesn't work, then neither does keeping me in your thoughts. Right? This guy's like, this idiot thinks that if he prays to God, God will cure his disease. That's ridiculous. I can cure his disease. with my thoughts. Makes a lot more sense, right? A lot more sense. Or another example of me almost dying for a stupid reason. About 6 months ago, I was driving on the interstate. There was a guy in front of me in a white pickup truck with a ladder in the back, okay? He was not driving very well. He was swerving, hitting on brakes, speeding, not driving very well at all, right? Like, obviously a Sunni. You guys know what I'm talking about. And just doing that. And the ladder fell out of the back of the truck. Bounced twice, really high in the air, right in front of me, and then landed perfectly flat in front of my car so that my car moved smoothly right over it. And I had to pull over because that was terrifying to me. That was so terrifying to me because what would have happened? What would have happened if I had been driving just a little bit faster, right? Ladder bounces twice, goes to the windshield, maybe I wouldn't be here today, right? But thankfully, I was driving just a little bit slower because I was texting. So let that be a lesson to all of you kids out there. Texting saves lives. Texting saves lives. So my wife and I, we've been married for about a year and a half. I love her very much. Yeah, it's great. You can cheer for her. It's cool, yeah. We are in an interracial marriage. I'm white and she's Catholic. She's like, well, I'm white. I'm like, yeah, now, right? Like 50 years ago, this marriage would have been progressive. That is 100% true, right? But a year and a half ago, it was great. We had just like this very traditional, like Southern wedding. It's a lot like Desi weddings, right? Very traditional wedding. If you guys don't know what that is, it's a thing where you take your entire life savings, okay? You put it all on a raft, and then you just set it on fire in the Atlantic Ocean. It's just this beautiful, traditional, Southern Viking wedding. I'm like, bye all my money. Bye all my money. It's great. My wife's a feminist. Any feminists here? Yeah? Just this half of the room. I understand, right? My wife's a feminist, but the other day, like we could sometimes get into arguments about that. Like the other day we got into this argument because she was saying that women still make 77 cents for every dollar that a man makes, right? You guys heard this? You guys have heard this, right? But like I studied economics in school, so I explained to her that's just because men naturally gravitate towards higher paying professions, right? Like doctor or engineer or CEO. Whereas women, this is true, women just sort of naturally gravitate towards lower paying professions like female doctor and female engineer and female CEO. Like it's not our fault you don't apply for the regular jobs. Just turn the application over. It's all right there in the fine print. I think men should make more than women. Yeah. You know why? Because we provide for women, right? We end up sharing all that extra income with our wives and our daughters to take care of them, right? Which can get really expensive, because I don't know if you know this, but they only make like 77 cents for every dollar that a man makes. So like, if anything, men should be getting a raise, right? Just to make up for all the sexism women experience in the workplace. Math checks out, guys, math checks out. This math is true in my own relationship. My wife is a female architect. That's true, she makes lady buildings. And yet she still makes, oh, and I'm a stand-up comedian, and yet she still makes only about 77 cents for every like 23 cents that I make, which is why I married her, right? So we could become one man. Thank you. I'll leave you guys with this. No! Talk to me after the show. Ask me questions. It'll be fun. Wife and I got married about a year and a half ago. It was great. A few weeks before the wedding, she surprised me. She sat me down and she told me that she was not going to take my last name. Yeah, because she's a feminist. And we all know a real feminist keeps the name she got from her dad. That's literally her patriarch. That makes no sense at all. Makes no sense. She was like, well, we could do a hyphen. I was like, I want to do a hyphen. That's just your dad's last name minus my last name. I don't even want to know what that equals. But you guys, we actually figured out the perfect solution. Perfect solution, she ended up taking my last name, right? And I took her first name. Now we're both Stephanie McLellan. I said, hey guys, how you doing? My name's Stephanie McLellan. My wife backstage, Stephanie McLellan. In case you can't tell, this is what equality looks like. Yeah, now we both make 77 cents for every dollar that a man makes. But my maiden name is Jeremy McLellan. Thank you guys so much for this. I appreciate it. Real quick announcements. This September and October, as my t-shirt suggests, I am going on tour for ICNA Relief, raising money for refugees. So please watch for that. Watch for that, and hope you guys can come and make it out. So thank you guys so much.